Sweden's totally different approach to the pandemic has failed, and it's now caved in and followed the rest of us into lockdown. Well, that's what some are saying, but has it really? Also, did Britain go into lockdown based on dodgy figures? The US media suddenly noticed that Hunter Biden is in trouble, and a leading figure who called for the punishment of COVID lockdown breakers gets caught breaking lockdown. My name's Mallen Baker, this is the Mallen Baker Show. One thing the whole world knows about the global response to the pandemic is that Sweden did it differently. While most of the other countries were imposing mandatory lockdowns, Sweden stuck to a very light framework of rules and then a call for voluntary social distancing, which by and large the population just did. Some people thought that they were the only sane ones. Others thought that they were the global pariahs, the ones who would let people die. Well, since then, both sides have looked at what actually happened in Sweden and concluded that events proved that they were right. Sweden had higher numbers of deaths than its Nordic neighbours, so the critics said that all those additional people died needlessly. But Sweden also had fewer deaths per million than a number of countries who implemented strict lockdown policies, and their economy was less badly affected, so people held their example up as exactly what we all should have done. One of their arguments was that Stockholm had almost certainly arrived at herd immunity, demonstrating that this could be achieved at a much lower rate of exposure than the epidemiologists were saying. And it did look as though the places that got hit the hardest at the start, such as Stockholm and London and New York, were not seeing a second wave when other parts of their respective countries started to. But now various people have declared that that is all over. Sweden's getting hit once again, and they themselves are starting to lose faith in what they did. They're implementing new lockdown measures, more in line with everyone else. The Washington Post said this: Sweden's anti-lockdown experiment flopped. Now it faces a wave of pandemic pain. Bloomberg: Swedes lose faith in COVID-19 strategy with virus rampant. Prime Minister Stefan Löfven said a few weeks ago that Swedes were no longer following the restrictions as closely as they had. So a ban has been introduced of gatherings of more than 8 people. Anders Tegnell, the chief epidemiologist who was responsible for the strategy, admitted that herd immunity seemed not to have been achieved after all. It's obvious that it does slow down transmission, but it's been difficult to understand how large that effect is and how it should be weighed against other factors that speed up transmission. That balance may have been different than I and many others believe. The atmosphere has been changed as well by a dip in public support, which had been pretty enduring, even through the most difficult periods. A poll at the end of November, though, found that confidence in the authorities' capacity to control the crisis had fallen from 42% to 55% of the previous month. 44% felt that not enough was being done to fight the pandemic, up from 31%, and more than 80% said that they were worried to some extent that Sweden's health service wouldn't be able to cope. And that seemed prescient. On Wednesday this week, Bjorn Eriksson, healthcare director for Stockholm, said that intensive care beds in Stockholm reached 99% capacity for the first time during the pandemic, in spite of extra capacity that has been created. Part of the reason for that, and this applies to a number of countries, is that hospitals cleared out a certain amount of non-COVID related care during the first wave, but mostly they are not doing that this time, and that means less capacity. But is the line true that all of this marks the total abject failure of Sweden's bold experiment? Let's step back from both of the polemical mindsets on this and just look at what the evidence suggests and what we can learn from it. First, let's remember again that this is a multiple variable problem. People are always comparing the performance of different countries, the identities of which they carefully select to prove whatever point they're trying to make. But mostly there are lots of factors at play and no two countries are easy to compare. Do you compare Sweden to its immediate neighbours, even though it has a different population size and density? Or do you compare it to other European countries? What about the role of national culture? What about how hard they were hit in the last flu season? What about age profile and other demographic factors? It's important to note that recent events haven't really ended the experiment, in spite of what the mainstream media are saying. The new restrictions are still a long way from a full lockdown. For any other country, this would be seen as a routine tweak. Only for Sweden is it painted as a total failure of its approach. And that's down to the tone of our politics, not really to do with the data. The thing is, if you look at Sweden's excess mortality, it's striking that there hasn't been any excess mortality this year over the usual. No more than there has been for its immediate neighbours. Of course, once you hit winter, you naturally do get more serious illness and death. Some have argued that an obsessive focus on COVID-19 has simply led people to see a second wave where actually all we were seeing was a standard winter increase in respiratory diseases. That argument's supported if you look at Sweden's figures. But of course there are other countries, and a number of them have gone well above standard rates of mortality. Slovenia, Italy, Belgium, Austria, all of these have been very high or extremely high excess death rates. And a number of them have slipped back into that territory for this second wave. And what that tells you is that there is the capacity for this to spread in a way that goes well beyond the norm, and therefore complacency is not available as a public policy position. But the fact that Sweden is not amongst those, or even amongst the ones like France and the UK and Spain, where there are moderate excess deaths, should tell us that a lighter touch approach to social distancing can be relatively effective. But would it actually work for anyone other than Sweden? Much has been made of Swedish people's willingness to voluntarily follow social distancing rules. So some argue that other countries have to impose harder restrictions to get the same degree of compliance from their unruly populations. But did you try it? Did you? In my experience, if you treat people like grown-ups, they tend to respond like grown-ups. But the other thing we now know from Sweden is that even with a light touch, there are limits to what people will happily tolerate. Eventually, they stop being as careful. And eventually, they also begin to lose their faith in the people in charge. It's interesting that the people of Sweden now have their doubts. Arguably just as interesting that it took this long. The excess deaths figure would imply the doubts are misplaced. But then on the other hand, the 99% ICU occupancy suggests that those figures alone don't tell the whole story. We should be able to look at both and accept that both are true and look for the nuanced implications. Or at least we could if the world hadn't been vaccinated against nuance. It could be as simple as people who in normal years would be passing in care homes of various causes end up instead in ICU with COVID-19, which gives you an organisational bottleneck, but not necessarily a crisis. But you still have to respect that this is something that can get out of control, as we've seen in other countries. Did they get their economic benefits from their policy? Maybe. In the summer, the Swedish economic figures were stronger than many others who went into full lockdowns, but the current situation is seen as a knock to the recovery. So this is never what people want to hear, but it remains too early to tell. For now, the mythology says that Sweden has been humbled. Herd immunity is no more, at least absent the vaccine. Hopefully more sober eyes will go over all of this in years to come to extract the real lessons. Now, in a moment, we'll look at some of the rest of the week's news. But first, this week, the UK's Committee on Climate Change released its most detailed report yet, mapping out the UK's path to net zero carbon by 2050. It represents a scaling up of Britain's ambition, with levels of planned emissions cuts to be higher and sooner. It provides the most detailed roadmap that any country's produced, showing the steps that will need to be taken, and it provides an updated costing for the project, which the BBC reported as cheaper than expected. Well, it all sounds lovely! And I've been a supporter in the past of the previous analysis that the Committee on Climate Change produced. But does this one stand up to scrutiny? Does it really show a way forward for an advanced capitalist economy to go to net zero while remaining prosperous and free? Or does it represent the sort of technocratic or left-wing dystopian future that some have been warning about? On Monday next week, I'll be doing a deep dive into what the Committee on Climate Change has just released and what does it mean. If you want to know the story behind the headlines and what it might mean for the future without having to trawl through a 1,000-page report, I kid you not, you want to join me then. That video being launched at 7 p.m. UK time, Monday the 14th of December. See you there. This was the week where the first vaccinations took place. Government ministers even got tearful about it. Others perhaps got tearful when it was noticed that the official statistics on which the most recent lockdown just ended was based have been revised downwards. When the decision was taken for lockdown, the latest survey from the Office of National Statistics was showing that the incidence of COVID in the community had surged from 4.3 per 10,000 people to 9.52 on the 17th of October. But in the latest survey dated 4th of December, the ONS had revised those historical numbers. Now the 17th of October is shown back down at 4.89 people per 10,000. So was that second lockdown an unnecessary self-inflicted wound? In the US, meantime, Trump supporters are furious because they've worked out that the vaccine and the season should all be just kicking in roughly at about the right time for Joe Biden to be taking credit for defeating COVID, which, given the way the media have been supporting him, is not an unreasonable assumption to make. If you want an example of that, consider this. The American media this week reported the fact that federal prosecutors are probing the taxes and other conduct for one Hunter Biden. Why is that of interest? Seems like this Hunter Biden may have been up to a few bad things, probably should be investigated. Except, of course, before the election, the media were steadfastly refusing to report on investigations into Hunter Biden. The New York Post was banned from Twitter for publishing a story about Hunter Biden. Facebook decided to downgrade stories in advance of a fact check. The media suggested the New York Post story was Russian disinformation. Even though Hunter Biden didn't actually deny the substance of the story as reported. I covered the story on this channel. I even asked the question, I wonder if they'll suddenly discover the story after the election's passed. I literally asked that question. Now look, the pro-Trump side are pointing at this and saying the only story here is the bias of the mainstream media. And they're right that it's a big part of the story. Absolutely. But it's not quite as simple and one-sided as they would like to think. The truth is that the facts about Hunter Biden were known by certain people months before the election, and they were released by the Trump campaign themselves at a timing specifically calculated to have the most influence on the election. You wouldn't have to be a wholly partisan journalist to ask yourself a hard question. Well, one side is trying to play us to the benefit of their campaign. Should we really just line up and play that part? Is this today's news or today's calculated release of old news? And of course, if the information could be sat on for a couple of months, it can be sat on for a couple more months. So the Trump campaign played their part in degrading this process. But that said, that excuse only really holds if the media generally were playing a straight bat. And in no way does that describe the media's behaviour in the US election 2020. They could not have been more overtly in the Biden camp. When they interviewed Trump, they asked why he ate babies. When they interviewed Biden, they asked how much does he love puppies. I'm only vaguely paraphrasing. The media are the ones who conspired in breaking the model that's supposed to justify their existence, holding power to account. Even then, at least the New York Times and the Washington Post and CNN, they just decided not to run stories about Hunter Biden. And that's their right. They decide what they publish. The social media companies, however, actively suppressed stories that they didn't like. Now, it shouldn't matter which political side you were on. You should find that disturbing. Never support a system you don't want used against you. Twitter banned the New York Post for its article about Hunter Biden. Facebook said it would downgrade such stories in advance of them being fact-checked. That's not about an editorial decision of what to publish. That is a decision to censor what you might choose to share or say to your friends or to your wider audience. This week, YouTube announced that it would begin to take down videos that promote the idea that the US 2020 election was won through widespread fraud, through software glitches, or a range of other theories. And, you know, on current evidence, I don't personally think any of those theories carry a huge amount of credibility, unlike the Hunter Biden story. But that isn't the point. I mean, I may be wrong. People should be allowed to put their arguments and present their evidence, and it shouldn't be down to YouTube to decide whether you're allowed to hear those voices or not. Where people put forward bad arguments, others will produce rebuttals. That's the whole point of how free speech works. But then it seems YouTube can't generally tell the difference between arguments against bad arguments and bad arguments. This week, Stephen Woodford of the Rationality Rules channel said that he'd had one of his videos debunking 5G conspiracy theories removed by YouTube. And this follows three debunking videos by Thunderfoot being similarly removed. YouTube's algorithm couldn't distinguish, it seemed, from a video arguing against an idea from one promoting the idea. And pointing it out didn't get an easy and rapid correction. It just begs the question, maybe you shouldn't be in the business of judging the quality of ideas if your judgment is that poor. In other news this week, Brexit limps ever onwards to its conclusion, and it seems that key EU countries have decided to provoke a no-deal outcome. Their expectation is reportedly that the UK will end up coming back to the table in a more compliant frame of mind once it's suffered a bit. Or it may be a colossal game of chicken. We'll soon find out. There is certainly trouble ahead, though. Honda shut down one of its plants temporarily because congestion at Britain's ports, even ahead of Brexit, has made a number of supply chains completely seize up. There's clearly going to be some significant short-term disruption when it all kicks off, deal or no deal. Will people start panic buying toilet rolls all over again? Or will they relax, knowing that the early teething problems will eventually pass? Well, they'll probably panic. But that's actually just one of those teething problems itself, and it will all calm down eventually. Football teams such as Millwall finally led a selected group of fans back into the stadium for their matches, only to be dismayed by a chorus of boos when they performed the ritual taking the knee. The club interpreted the boos as an indication of blatant racism, and were all shocked, shocked, I tell you. Forums for Millwall fans suggested that motivations may have been more about associations of the act with the political organisation Black Lives Matter, capital B, capital L, capital M, who some associate with attempts to tear down statues of figures like Winston Churchill. But no one's listening to each other, so it was just entered onto the record as yet another scandal. And speaking of scandals, a woman celebrated her 60th birthday. I know! Unfortunately, she did so with friends, in a way that breached strict lockdown rules. It was Sky News presenter Kay Burley, one of the media pack, that had hounded Dominic Cummings, saying surely he would resign for having slightly broken a legalistic reading of the lockdown rules. Now, she has not been sacked as a result, but Sky announced yesterday she would not appear on air for 6 months. The Brits can forgive many things. Hypocrisy apparently is not one of them. Now, personally, I have sympathy for anyone who had a birthday with a zero on the end who wants to celebrate. But I did think that Burley's behaviour in the Cummings affair was pretty low. So, you know, maybe this is how that karma thing works. Now, in a moment, we'll respond to a couple of comments and then we'll get to the final thought for the week. But first, one of my ambitions before I die is to see the Great Barrier Reef. Some people tell me I better get a move on because it won't be there for much longer. They say the effects of climate change will hit coral reefs more severely than any other natural environment, especially when you add in other aspects of pollution that are hitting them at the same time. So I might be inclined to want to believe the alternative version of Peter Ridd, the contrarian scientist who challenges the establishment view of the reef as imminently endangered. Like me, you'd probably like to know what's the truth. And with all of the claims and counterclaims being thrown backwards and forwards, it can be hard to know what to believe. On Wednesday, I'll be looking at some of the detail of what we know from the science of coral reefs, what we think might be in store for them, and what are the points of dispute, and how well does each side's argument stack up. Is climate change killing the Great Barrier Reef? And what can we learn from how that argument's playing out? Join me to look at those questions in the video going live next Wednesday, 16th of December, 7 p.m. UK time. See you there. Last week, I covered the case of the Eton master sacked for refusing to take down his video presentation from YouTube. I had one comment on that case that said this: a headmaster may have the authority to control what's taught in the school, but what authority does he have over what a teacher posts on YouTube? The only justification I can see is if a video was created in school time, in which case it could be considered school property. This depends on the nature of your employment contract. Many companies will have clauses that say your personal conduct outside of work should not be such as to reflect badly on the company or bring it into disrepute, and the company may well define exactly what that means. So, for instance, this week, I've already mentioned the suspension of Kay Burley by Sky TV. You could argue that her decision to have a birthday party breaking lockdown rules was none of Sky's business. But given the nature of her job, that is an untenable argument. When I worked for Business in the Community, I was aware that the blog I wrote, this was in the days before people were used to such things, trod a fairly fine line, because I would write what I wanted, and sometimes that might include criticism of a company that was actually a member of Business in the Community. Now, that never did come back to bite me, but I was always aware that it might. Now, personally, I don't think that that YouTube video in question crossed that line. But that's saying that had I been the head teacher, I would have made a different decision, not that it wasn't his decision to make. And if you don't like it, don't work for the sort of company that requires constraints on your public activity. Now, the most recent video I did was on the role of water vapour in climate change, and it provoked a flurry of comments, many making very familiar points. Here's one of them that comes up quite a lot, so let's address it here. In all your research, have you ever found any expert willing to say what the optimum temperature of the Earth is? This question is based on the premise that climate scientists must have a view of what the ideal temperature is, and if people can't name it, then somehow that invalidates any action to prevent global warming. It's based on a fallacy, because it's not about an ideal temperature, there's no such thing. Over geological timescales, life could evolve to fit a wide range of different temperatures. What it doesn't do so well is to adapt in the face of rapid change. So the exact temperature isn't the point. It's relative stability that matters. Some people say the Earth was warmer millions of years ago and life was thriving. The more relevant part is that the fossil records tell us that times associated with rapid changing climate saw major extinction events. Now, that doesn't mean we're in the middle of a mass extinction now, as the campaigners sometimes claim. It does mean that the fact the Earth may have been warm billions of years ago isn't a particularly useful or relevant discussion point in our current context. As a species, we're prone to getting distracted. Items that we focus on become elevated to being hugely important, while possibly more important things may be hovering out of sight. The pandemic has given us some examples of that. Over the last 6 months, we've focused on it relentlessly, tracking fatality numbers and feeling everyone like a personal wound. The toll of the pandemic became more important than the state of public health and mortality rates overall, which obviously makes no sense. This week, where we've seen a lot of people celebrating the first vaccinations for COVID-19, we've had another example of this. A number of poverty campaign groups have gotten together, called themselves the People's Vaccine Alliance, to trumpet the claim that rich countries are hoarding all the vaccine at the expense of the poorest countries. And this is all down to the greed of capitalism. The companies want to be paid for vaccines that should be given away free to everyone that needs it. It's a compelling argument, and made so because there's an element of truth there that's easy to see, but it's an example of the downside of how campaign groups jump onto whatever is the area of biggest focus of the day to boost their campaigns. Firstly, without capitalism, the miracle of the rapid production of these vaccines wouldn't have happened in the first place. But secondly, it's worth asking why it is that the predictions that the pandemic would devastate the populations of Africa haven't happened. A continent of 54 countries with 1.3 billion people has had fewer COVID fatalities than Britain alone. One of the likely explanations is age. Almost a fifth of Britons are over 65, less than 2% across Africa. Life expectancies there are low because of malaria, which kills close to 100,000 people a year in Nigeria alone. This is expected to surge in the coming year, dwarfing any COVID deaths. TB, AIDS-related illness, the impacts of poverty, all of these are far more important in changing things in Africa. Health outcomes in the continent have been made worse by the impacts of Western lockdowns, for sure, because of COVID. But if we're focusing on the best health outcomes, not just being fixated by the thing that's in front of our faces, we should be focusing on the actions that fit each situation. And that calls for a focus on economic development and application to the diseases that are actually taking lives there, particularly malaria. It's a reminder to look beyond the obvious and to remember that that's the one thing the headline writers, the campaign groups and the social media influencers with an eye to what will go viral, that's the thing that they find hardest to do. Now, so far, I've not had a video removed in the way that I described earlier with rationality rules and Thunderfoot. Hopefully it won't happen. But both of those channels are pretty mainstream. So if it can happen to them, it can happen to me. Stephen Woodford announced this week he wouldn't be doing any more debunking videos because of YouTube taking that sort of action. And for me, that is the danger of these situations, with the people who self-censor, just in case. Luckily, the support of good people on Patreon means that I can and I will continue to make videos on all subjects that I think are important, regardless of whether they get demonetized or whatever worse YouTube can think of. It enables me to put in the time as well that it takes to produce 3 videos or more per week, even though a number of them require quite a bit of time and research. So if you would like to add your support to the independent, fact-focused and non-ideological content that I aim to produce here, please consider signing up at patreon.com/Mallen Baker. It is always appreciated. Either way, have a great week. My name is Mallen Baker. This is the Mallen Baker Show.